And then you have one dangled in front of your face, you're probably gonna want to eat that too. Not much is gonna stop you. So, I mean, that's how you feel about the Super Bowl. I mean, that is the chocolate cake with the ultimate frosting. You're gonna try to go get it if you can. You know, that's the best you can.
Andy Reid guaranteeing that if I could get off my hill tonight, but for the snow, I would go find some chocolate cake somewhere. A little cheeseburger, a little chocolate cake, a little football tonight between the Rams and Cardinals. We're going to do some fill in the blank. And, Mike, some of these are very, very broad, so they can go any direction you want. For example, the Chiefs blank.
The Chiefs look like the Chiefs of old. I mean, again, no points in the first quarter. Zip, zip. Pittsburgh was doing exactly what they had to do to win the game. Defense was playing well, and then the defense has scored the first points of the game for them. But then 35 points were scored in the second and third quarter by the Chiefs. And they didn't need that many because Pittsburgh can't score that many points. But that's what I would say. They look like the Chiefs that we're used to.
Yeah, I mean, I guess to borrow the quote from Juju Smith-Schuster as he was talking about a division rival last year, the Chiefs is the Chiefs.
Yeah.
Because they are. And the thing that amazes me about them, the character of the players, the character of the coaching staff, the refusal to panic, when it feels like it's a night that is going to go along with the narrative of total team effort by the Steelers, no rhyme or reason as to how in the hell they would win that game. It was all going their way. 7-0 after the punts and punts and punts and punts. And it would have been very easy to adapt to the circumstances if you're the Chiefs and just accept the fact that it's not your night. And then to the hell with that. First drive after that, touchdown. Then they stop the Steelers. Next drive, touchdown. And the route was on. And that's what's so dangerous about the Chiefs, Mike. There was a game a couple of years ago that is so indicative of the Chiefs. It was a Raiders game early in the season, like week two of the 2019 season. Final score was 28-10. The Chiefs scored all their points in the second quarter. Yeah. Like, they've got that ability to drop the hammer and score a bunch of points anytime they want.
Yeah, they can knock you out. That's when they'll rope-a-dope you, right? First quarter, no points, give up 7 on defense, and then they'll drop the hammer on you and knock you out and put you in a position where you are now completely out of your game plan and have to throw yourself back into this game. So, you know, there were a few teams. They were that team. Buffalo was that team, you know, that just – weren't looking like what we thought they were going to be, but they both seem to be righting the ship when it needs it the most, and that's in the playoffs. And now we get that great matchup this week.
Well, the Chiefs were that basketball team that was down 6 points in the second half and goes on an 18-2 run that you knew right. Was coming at some point. That's what they are. The Bills, in contrast, on Saturday night were the Harlem Globetrotters, and the Patriots were the Washington Generals. And that's our next topic in fill in the blank. The Bills' offense against the Patriots – what
was surprising to me, no contest, because I've said this before, the reason that New England was winning the way they were was, to me, their defense. Everybody talked about Mac Jones, who was coming along well as a rookie, but the defense put the offense in position to never have to really throw themselves back into games. They were always winning, or it was very, very close. And that was on the defense. When it got pushed to be on Mac Jones' shoulder, we'd seen multiple interceptions in back-to-back weeks, multiple interceptions yesterday. They got taken out of their game this weekend. They got taken out of their game plan. So to me, it was surprisingly, and I put surprisingly in there because I've loved this New England defense, surprisingly a no contest.
Oh, you know, Mike, from the first drive, when Josh Allen throws the Joe Montana to Dawson Knox playing the role of Dwight Clark in the back of the end zone, and just like Montana, Allen thought he was throwing it away. For me, the moment, though, when Micah Hyde makes that shot out of a cannon interception on a play that I thought was a touchdown, and the Bills just keep going, just going. It's never happened before. If you haven't heard it, and even if you have, just let it sink in. It's never happened in the history of the National Football League, regular season or postseason, that a team on offense, every time it had the ball, scored a touchdown or took a knee in victory formation. No interceptions, no punts, no field goals, no turnovers on downs, touchdown or kneel down. And it happened against the guy who is the consensus greatest NFL coach of all time. It's inconceivable, Mike.
And if there was ever a time where Sean McDermott was not going to pick his foot up off the throat of an opponent, it was this game. He was just going to keep going and pushing and scoring. And because he knows what he's up against here, and you have that opportunity to stunt on this team, man, you do it. And that's exactly what he did. So the Bills, to me, just like the Chiefs, again, looked like what we thought they were going to be. This was a team that statistically, offensively, and defensively were in, what, the top five, top ten, one of the only teams to be doing that. But they didn't look like that all year. Well, they looked like it in this game. That's why everybody was hoping this game would be the AFC Championship game between them and Kansas City. Well, we get it a week early.
Last topic, the officiating in the wild card round, blank.
I mean, I probably would use a word that might get us in trouble from the FCC. So I'll just say horrific. I mean, when you get a game, the game I did, where immediately after the Cincinnati and the Raiders game, it basically comes out that group, that officiating crew, isn't doing any more playoff games. I mean, it was that bad. And yeah, we've seen some very, very penalties have been up this year. I'm not a big fan of that, but yeah, it's been pretty spotty.
And you know what? We're not on any over-the-air network. Not that I want to encourage you to use any of that language, but it's Peacock. And I've heard plenty of bad language on Peacock, and it's Sirius. I've heard plenty of bad language on Sirius, too. I'm going to call it Orwellian, Mike. That was the lead of the item that I wrote on Saturday night. Once we saw the pool report from Walt Anderson, I said 2 + 2 really is 5, because that's what they want us to believe. The erroneous whistle, the official explanation from the NFL, the crew discussed it, and they determined that the whistle came after the catch was made in the end zone for a touchdown. Well, why do we even care if it was an erroneous whistle then if it came after the catch? But that's what they want us to believe. It's a little gaslighting. It's a little 1984. It's a lot of bull crap that we're being fed by the NFL on this, all because they didn't want to admit that they got it wrong and they should have had a do-over of the play. That's their rule. That's their rule. You may not like the rule, but when the whistle blows accidentally before the play is over, the rule is you do the play again. Doesn't matter what the outcome of the play is. I don't like that. It shouldn't happen, but right. It did. They just disregard the rule book, and they go with the outcome on the field. And, of course, Raiders fans are justifiably upset about it.
At times, what do they think? We're idiots? I mean, I was there at that game. Right after he released the ball, you heard the whistle. I mean, we're not morons out here to try and say, oh, yeah, okay, I guess it was after he caught the ball. Give me a break. I mean, that was a joke. I will say this, though, Mike. The play absolutely should have been called dead and come back. But I will also say, to me, it did not affect the outcome of the play.
Didn't matter. But that's not the rule. That's not the rule.
Exactly,
that's the problem.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly right. Yes.
But here's why they're able to get past it, Mike. There's always another bright, shiny object to attract our attention.
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.